Thank you very much for your patience, dear panelists and audience. We shall now commence this session. The moderator for this session is Mr. Sibtain Naqvi. Mr. Sibtain Naqvi is the head of university relations at Habib University and editor of Ham Khayal, the university magazine. An IBA graduate, he writes for several English publications on a range of subjects including art, culture, history, education, environment, and social issues. Mr. Naqvi is the author of IBA's official history and is currently engaged in research on the city of Amroha in UP, India, and the artist Sadakan. The session is now yours, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This is an extremely pertinent session, given the situation in the country, what has been happening with one of our public institutions over the past few days. And while talking with my distinguished authors and panelists, the word that kept coming up prior to this discussion over here was that it's very timely. It's very pertinent, it's very timely in our country at this junction, and of course, starting off. Institutions and a country's development, a nation's development, there are different takes upon it. So the previous understanding about development was that it's due to historical conditions or climate or geography or the works of certain people. So what is known as the great man theory. But over the years, this view has been challenged, and there have been some work along this, especially very famous work which these authors have mentioned in the book. It's a study by James Robinson and Smaglu, which is about how institutions impact countries. So we can see this, and we have been seeing this. So if you compare, say, two cities, San Diego, which is in California, and Tijuana, which is on the Baja coast in Mexico, they're separated only about by 30, 40 kilometers. And yet the development of each city is completely different. You see this in North Korea and in South Korea. Same climatic conditions, same historical baggage, all those things, but of course, remarkably different trajectories. And then here on the local front, you can see this in East Punjab and West Punjab. I have made the journey from Pakistani Punjab into the Indian Punjab many times across the border. And as soon as you cross the border, you see this change. The yield goes up, the towns look a little different, development is generally higher. So this is because of the institutional impact. And I would now like to just introduce our distinguished panelists and our co-authors, starting in the order of which they're sitting next to me. Dr. Mahmood Ayub, he's been a senior manager with the World Bank and the United Nations Development Program, and he has over 35 years experience in economics, development, and operations. Next to him, Dr. Turab Hussain. Turab is an associate professor of economics at LUMS. His research interests have ranged from migration theory and policy, poverty, rural development, and trade and development. Next to him is Ms. Shahnaz, Wazir. The career spans 35 years in policy and practice in government and private sector. She's a former Fed Minister of State for Education. She's also served as a special assistant to the Prime Minister on social sectors and is the acting president of Zabist University. Next to her is Javaid Ahmed Saab, who's a senior fellow of strategy and marketing communications. He's been chairperson of marketing and management at the IOBM for over a decade. And he's focusing on governance strategy and has supervised CBM's or IOBM's MPhil research. Welcome, all of you. Now, just a few numbers I would like to highlight with regards to Pakistan before we move into the conversation with the panelists. Now, according to the last global competitive report published in 2015, Pakistan, out of 140 countries, is at 126th. It was 129th last year. We moved up three ranks, but we're still somewhere in the bottom, and our peer group are war-torn countries and countries that have been facing civil war and all of that. We're also quite low on HDI, low on the ranking of Transparency International, education, where we are at 127th, and so on and so forth. And these numbers are online. You can easily look them up. And they gave a pretty dismal picture of our country. But within this somewhat dim environment, there are, as the book so aptly names, candles in the dark. These nine institutions, which range across public and private sector, they in different areas: education, healthcare, poverty alleviation. They're also at different stages of growth. So a couple of them are over half a century, over 50 years old. Latest ones are just started in the last decade. And then we move on into the determinants and analysis. So this is the book's successful side. The unsuccessful side are two institutions which once upon a time, in fact in recent history for many of us, which were actually very successful. And one of them actually started the PIA. It actually started other very successful institutions, started in the sense that it consulted it. They worked with them, they helped establish them, which have of course moved well on while we're sort of left on the wayside. Now, I'll now start talking to my co-authors. Sir, how did this collaboration between an educationist or an academic and a development specialist such as yourself, first of all, can you tell us how this came about and what prompted you to actually work on this study?
Thank you very much. Basically, it began when I was visiting staff at Lums University, and it occurred to me that while most of the history about Pakistan, the present descriptions, the narrative about Pakistan is very negative, there are certain what we call candles in the dark that are worth mentioning, so that we have a more balanced approach to this process. So we selected essentially nine enterprises, which I will mention later on, which ones they are. But that was the origin of the work.
Yeah. Turab, just, there's a saying, perception beats reality. Hmm. Now, the perception of the larger public in public institutions is so low that one of the institutions that you mentioned over here, the IBA, which has been pillar of excellence for 60 years, even when I was studying in the IBA, there used to be this saying that IBA is semi-public. I never quite understood it. And later on, when I was done and when I did my own work on it, it's absolutely not semi-public. It is as public as any educational institution can be. So this perception of public institutions just not good enough, how do you tackle that? Even though, back in the day, in the 50s and 60s, the most talented people would aspire to work in a public institution, government sector.
That's a very, very interesting question. And for economists, they've been trying to answer that for many years, and there are conflicting views on this. So if you look at these case studies, there are total nine. Out of these, there are six which are in the public sector. And these are obviously successful entities. Hmm. So one message which comes out of this work is that the standard binary, which a lot of people and economists also have had, that you associate public sector with government failure, with inefficiency, with rent seeking, and you associate the private sector with efficiency and gains and welfare improvement, that binary is very simplistic. Ours is a much more nuanced approach, and in some sense this is the evidence out there. There are six organizations which operate in the public sector, but they've been very successful. Now, there are reasons why they're very successful, and we can discuss that as we move along with this session. But one of them is how independent the management is from the ownership, how autonomous that is. Mm. So there's certain conditions, or you can say preconditions, and if those are met, you can have public sector enterprises which can perform as well as private sector. And I'm not going here into the principles of public versus private, that whether it's a public good provision, whether it's a natural monopoly, but just looking at organizations, this binary is very simplistic, and we require a more nuanced approach. And also, if you look at the historical experience of a lot of countries which have developed post-1945, you have examples of Korea, Taiwan, you have examples of Singapore, you have examples or Western countries which have very well-functioning public sector. So it is how the public sector is organized, what are the incentive structures, what are the policies and procedures governing the organization, which then explains success.
Hmm. Yeah, that's please.
I think it's important that you mention that IPA is considered or viewed as a private-public entity. And the reason, of course, is that IPA has had some excellent performance recently, and Dr. Ishrat Hussain is here, who has made a tremendous difference. But it was not always the same. IPA really went through a very difficult time during the late 90s, and if you look at its trajectory, it basically performed well in the 50s, one of the earliest public schools, institutions, and it came down, as I mentioned, in the early, in the mid to late 90s. Now, what determines the performance of public enterprises is clearly that it's how it is managed, how the government places itself within the management structure. And if you look at some organizations in Brazil, for example, which are public organizations like CVRD or Petrobras, these are organizations totally in the public sector, but they do well because they are considered as if private.
Hmm. So there are various reasons of how do we get there, and they're still to be worked out.
Exactly.
I will move on to the panelists, starting with Ms. Vazili. If you could just give your views on this enterprise and perhaps on your own experience working in, you know, public and private institutions.
Thank you very much, Sibtain. I think that this is, as I said earlier to you, it's very timely because there's a pervasive public discourse going on just now that Pakistan is a failing state or near close to a failing state, and one of the reasons for it is, of course, poor political leadership, corruption, lack of law and order, lack of several other things, which underpin the whole fact that the state seems to be crumbling from within. But here's a book, I think, that really, true to its title, Candles in the Dark, tells you that, as the authors have said, in a fragile and hostile environment and in a very tumultuous and prohibitive operational context, there are institutions that can actually do very well. And it also, I think, this book really puts to bed the whole myth that institutions fail only because there's a lot of political interference and there's a lot of corruption. And the book is, I think, I wouldn't like to call it a manual because it's much, much more than a manual, but for myself, since I'm heading an institution, it really very clearly defined what were the key characteristics of a successful organization. And there are several characteristics they define, and they also identify three criteria for success. Mm-hmm. So I think many of the people here in this room are obviously interested in institutional effectiveness, and they talk about success, which results, resilience, and legitimacy. These are the three areas, or three indicators of success. Results means what does the institution produce? What are its outcomes, what is visible, what is the evidence. Resilience is, of course, its ability to adapt, to change, to modify, to perhaps almost preempt certain things that might be happening in society and already be ready to respond to them. And the third thing, which I think is very, very important, is legitimacy. What's the legitimacy of these institutions in the eyes of the public? And as I was, when I was asked to review the book and I saw these institutions that had been selected, I thought if a public poll had been taken, some of them would have automatically come to the top, you know? Mm. So I think it's really full credit to the authors. IBA and LUMS automatically are the two names that come to the top as far as higher education is concerned. And both of them have parallels, although IPA is, as you said, it's born actually in a public environment of the Karachi University, but it has been allowed to, and it has fought for I think a lot of the features of a private sector institution. LUMS, with full credit to Syed Babar Ali and several people who associated with it, actually set the bar on how private institutions in the tertiary sector can in fact be very, very effective and very successful. So my take on the book in brief, and I hope I have another chance to come back and talk about some aspects of these particular institutions, is that the yardstick that they have applied of 11 indicators really is, regardless of public or private sector, it cuts across both spheres. And that, I think, is a very, very important statement in Pakistan, because most people think public sector cannot deliver. And right now we are in the midst of this imbroglio of the PIA and this heated debate in the country that if you were to privatize it, it would be very effective. But this book doesn't necessarily argue that. It says that you can be a public sector organization provided there's visionary leadership, there's autonomy, there's good staffing, there's internal resilience and several other things. So I think the main thesis of this book is, despite a dysfunctional institutional infrastructure in Pakistan, and which applies both to public and private entities, that it is possible for both public sector and private sector organizations to be really successful. So to me, I think this is a must-read for just about anyone who's heading an organization or is in the senior management of an organization.
Interestingly, the book also gives us snippets of successful public and private institutions in other countries which we see as, you know, borderline, you know, in difficult straits, or such as Nigeria and elsewhere. So, so you've been able to collect that information also and sort of do this parallel study between Pakistani institutions and those. I'm just going to ask Javaid Saab now, for your view, sir.
Yes. My background is from, I spent more than 25 years in industry and the last 10 years in academics now. And my area of work in the university revolves around this subject of competitiveness of organizations. A lot of the literature on competitiveness and success of organizations that I am exposed to is the private sector. But I have no reason to believe that many of those concepts do not apply to the public sector. I believe they do. There is some recent, I am not an economist nor a banker. I have read some recent literature coming out of the Asian Development Bank and also from the World Bank, where the discourse of economic development is now including institutions, the important role that institutions play, rather than the macroeconomic developing and then the institutions evolving after that. They are now saying that it's the institutions who develop, as a consequence of which macroeconomic development takes place. So this is some of the emerging literature that interests me a lot. That is the reason why when Sibtain Saab sent me a copy of this book, I thought that this could hardly be more timely than what it was. And you know, they say that from a university point of view, research on organizational capacity and competitiveness and the way it moves forward is through two vehicles. One are case studies, and I think this book has 9 excellent case studies. I believe I'm qualified to use the word excellent because I use case studies a lot in my work. And the other is research, empirical research. I was presenting a case study at an Indian Institute of Management conference in Dubai 2 weeks ago. And there, the dean of the university said that case studies and research are like the two wheels of a bicycle that carry knowledge forward. So I think this is an invaluable contribution to the existing literature in Pakistan on competitiveness of organizations. Just one more comment, Sibtain Saab. You mentioned about Pakistan's competitiveness as having gone up to 126 from 129. In 2005, this figure was 75. Today it is 126. And the graph is a very steady downward graph. And I was looking at this graph and I saw that throughout this period when the competitiveness of our organizations was going down from the 75th rank to the 126th rank, there were all sorts of, this happened during the years of the PPP, this happened during the years of the of the military government of Musharraf, this happened during the PML Nawaz. So irrespective of the type of ideology, it seems that the competitiveness decline of the country seems to be, to a non-expert like me, to be continuing on a very deliberate, constant path. So I think a discourse on this subject is extremely important for us, and I think this book is an excellent starting point for that. So that is my take on at that level. I can also argue at the individual level, but let's do that at a slightly later stage.
Let's do that. I just have a question for, and Ayub sir, you can take this one. One of the success stories over here is a Benazir income support program, great program. We all, let me just, for the large audience, let me just read this little section. The number of beneficiaries has increased from 1.7 million households in financial year 2008-2009 to nearly 5 million by the end of 15. I'm sure it's more now. And annual disbursements rose from 15.8 in 2008 to almost 90 billion. Now it's 104 billion as per the last report that we have had, which means that the Benazir income support program is not just a story of a good public institution, but it's also a great story for a larger political scenario. There's a change of government from in the past 2 years, and in our country, there's a common concept that the next government or the next party doesn't carry forward the last party's policies and all that. How is it that this happened? And I think it's a shining example of across the board, you know, political leadership and rising above all the, you know, differences.
Let me first get back, if you don't mind, to
Zarur.
A couple of points that Javaid Saab raised. One was on the question of the case studies and the other on the research methodology. In terms of, just for the information of the audience, we had selected 9 enterprises, organizations, public and private. These are LUMS, IBA, Benazir Income Support Program, NADRA, Motorway Police, Punjab Education Foundation, Edi Foundation, Research Rescue 1122, and Shaukat Khanum Cancer Hospital. Now, this is obviously not an exhaustive list. There are many others that could have been included here, which are not, but for want of time, we could not really go into details of the process. So the good news is that there are others also that are doing well. The second point on the research methodology, basically what we had were detailed discussions with the organizations, with the institutions, with the heads of the institutions, with the staff, and also with those who are using the resources, the facilities of these organizations. So it was a fairly comprehensive discussion. For example, for IBA, we were here for, I was here for 3 or 4 days and had essentially, thanks to Dr. Ishrat Hussain, met a whole gamut of people working on IBA. To come back to your question about BISP, Benazir Income Support Program, I think the success is primarily due to the fact that the government, from the beginning, there was ownership of this program. Even before the mechanisms were put in place, poverty score and so on, there was ownership of the program. And the other thing was, because of that, when the government changed, many people feared that there would be progress will be left behind and would be stopped. But it didn't happen that way. That the government, the new government, essentially not only continued the Benazir income support program, but even increased the budget for it.
But can this be replicated across other public programs that have been initiated and carried forward? And Turab, you can take this.
There are two other examples of what you've just mentioned. It's in the context of Punjab primarily. So Rescue 1122. So Rescue 1122 was formed. It was an initiative of Dr. Rizwan Nasir, who was from the private sector. He came up with this idea. It took him many years to finally get the ordinance done and was established in the Punjab. This is the time of Pervez Musharraf, PMLQ government. But talking about how social legitimacy or the social capital and credibility is important in an organization, because this organization was filling a major gap in emergency service provision, because of the fact that it was independent, its service was very efficient, you know, the 7-minute response time, led to what? As soon as there was a change in government, there was this fear that perhaps the finances would be cut down. But politicians, end of the day, are interested in the number of votes they can garner in an election. So if an organization within the public sector is doing well, there's no reason for them to roll back.
Right.
So a rational politician, and that's exactly what happened in this case. So it was taken up, and W1122 is doing fairly well in the Punjab currently under the new setup, new government. And in fact, in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa also, they've adopted this service. So it's also an excellent example of how through a change in government, just because that organization has shown result, it has social legitimacy, that a change in government does not affect it. Same is the case with the Punjab Education Foundation, which has seen, again, numerous changes of government. But because it's a very well-functioning program, it's public-private partnerships, it's been adopted, and now it is in the center stage of the education policy of the Punjab province.
Right.
So there are these examples of resilience towards changes in government purely as a result of efficiency of service and legitimacy amongst the society.
I mentioned BISP because that's a national program, whereas the PEF and the 1122 are provincial programs. But yes, of course, you're absolutely right. If it works, then it works, and it's for everybody's public good. Why just these institutions are generally speaking from Sindh and Punjab? Any examples from?
I think this is a very good question, and if you look, there are essentially organizations from Karachi, from Lahore, and Islamabad. The reason, frankly, is that we were not able to get the same type of information. So we restricted ourselves to these studies. However, future work should really extend this work to other provinces. And I have no doubt there must be other successful organizations in other provinces.
Sibtain, I wanted to add a couple of things here. I was in government when we did the BISP, the Benazir Income Support Program, and also NADRA. You know how NADRA was really structured, constructed to be a very state-of-the-art, technical, proficient organization. Both of these, actually, there's some distinguishing features, and these are the autonomy of their boards. Dr. Ishrat Hussain is present here. He is a board member of BISP and several other, I think, very eminent and experienced people. So the political leadership took the decision to buffer these organizations against political interference itself. And I think that that was part of a major part of the reason why these have succeeded. And NADRA has done phenomenally well. Pakistan has, I think, the fourth or fifth largest database of individual profile database of the CNICs. They have been contracted by several countries like South Africa and several other countries to develop their digital passports as well. So NADRA is about autonomy, it's about efficiency, it's about modern technology, it's about results, time framing, clear-cut visions, and the need that was fulfilled. I want to come back, and so was BISP. BISP is a very large program. It can, graduate to another level today. But I want to raise a fundamental question here, which I think pops up in this book. which is about personalized leadership of institutions. If Imran Khan was not there, and in the future, what will happen to Shaukat Khan Memorial? And similarly with Eidi. And the book really presents this narrative around Eidi very well, that because of Eidi, because of his persona, people trust him. Agar Abdul Sattar Eidi sahab na hote, aur unka itna trust na hota logon ke zehnon mein, log unko is tarah tasleem na karte, to unko donations na milti, to ye kaise sara itna bada infrastructure khada ho jata. So I think the question here is, and the book points it out, that initially the visionary leadership is critical. The leadership that sets clear goals, asks for outcomes and results, but then what will happen afterwards? Because right now the Eidi Foundation is led principally by the Eidi family. And so the transition from personalized leadership, which is I think a big issue in many organizations, to the institutionalized leadership is really critical. And that's what would be very interesting if the authors of this book will go back some years from now and see what happened to Eidi Foundation. How did it institutional, how did it transform itself to something sustainable? Because clearly its ambulance service and its response emergency services, it's an outstanding organization. Similarly, Shaukat Khanum. So I think that these are some questions hanging in the air.
Yeah.
Once again, I refer to LUMS and IBA because I know them quite well. And there, I think the visionary leadership has made that transition. It has made that transition to institutionally embedded systems that meet all these indicators of effective organizations.
Right.
So PEF, Punjab Education Foundation, is in the process of doing that. Similarly, I think that if the motorway police can continue to be protected from patronage, political patronage, it will continue to deliver well. So the singular question in Pakistan is, we always say, if the leader is right, everything will be right. But this book doesn't argue that alone. It says, yes, you need a good leader, but you really need 10, 12 other things as well in these institutions. So I think this personality focus in Pakistan, yeah, and the persona focus in Pakistan ultimately has to give way to institutional.
So you need to move from transformational leaders, sort of people who set up, into transactional leaders who can then carry it forward and by using principle of management. Turab, Eidi, successful institution, is it really institutionalized itself?
When we were looking at Eidi and comparing it to other organizations, Eidi came across as quite an anomaly because it defies all the standard best practices of organizational management, very centralized, a family affair and so on. And then you look at the span of operations and that's completely mind-boggling how they've achieved it in the last 5 decades. So what Begum Shahnaz Wazir Ali said is very important. It depends. So leadership is important, but the leader should have an understanding of the importance of building an institution. So in the case of Eidi, that isn't there. And there's this big question mark as to what's going to happen after his demise. In the case of Shaukat Khanum, for example, and other institutions, we see that the leadership there had an understanding of that. So they gave autonomy to the management, they came up with policies and procedures, codified those. So in some sense, that visionary leadership was building an institution. Time will of course tell how far they're successful. But compared to Eidi, they're definitely much better in terms of institutional development.
Right. Yeah, I just want to comment briefly, if I can. I think this this book says that sustainability is one of the three key success factors. And it has examples of sustainable, successful institutions. I think IBA, LUMS, and I think Dr. Ishrat also has a history of doing that. He did that at the State Bank as well. I asked myself the question from an academic viewpoint, what is the difference between a leader-led or a leader-focused organization and a sustainable organization? And is it something to do with the leader putting into place the complete value chain of that organization, processes, people, systems, resources, throughout the value chain? Is that the way for moving, as you said, from a transformational leader and a leader who's then leaving behind a solid value chain, which then is perhaps what you call the transactional value chain.
I think, Javaid, on the leadership, I think the key point was made that it does make a difference to an extent, but ultimately it is what is institutionalized that's important. In the case of IBA again, Dr. Ishrat has essentially codified all the rules and regulations into one place so that whether he is there or not, everyone will know what are the rules and regulations that need to be followed. On sustainability, I would say that the other aspect of sustainability is to what extent can the organization get away from dependence, excessive dependence on outside resources. And in that sense, if you look at Benazir Income Support Program or Punjab Education Foundation, that they're still quite heavily dependent on foreign financing. Benazir Income Support Program is by and large run by funding from international agencies. And hopefully over time, they can try to reduce the dependence on these resources.
Right. Turab, economist, I'm going to ask a pure market-led question. Can public and private institutions compete for the same market successfully, or is it zero sum?
No, of course they can. As I said, the principle of public sector provision needs to be understood. I mean, where do you require the public sector? Where you have public goods and services provision, where you have market failures, where the private sector, their externality is generated and there's suboptimal provision by the private sector. You talk about health and education, for example, in that. Where there are natural monopolies, so if you have a natural monopoly, it's better that the public sector provides it. Where there are equity issues, you know, living in a country with a large segment of the population which is poor, so there are certain services which need to be provided by the government, certain social safety nets, for example. But in other goods, you know, you can have public-private competition. It's not a zero-sum game. In the education sector, we have the case of IBA and LUMS, two competing institutions. It works excellently for the public. They have choices.
Can I just interrupt, though? IBA was set up in 55. Yeah. LUMS is a private institution set up in 1985. But since AKU came in 1983, which was the first private university in Pakistan, there have been a succession of good private and public, good private educational institutions, but not really any on the educational side. So more people are now opting for a primary, for a private education, whether it's in the primary, secondary, or higher education.
Yeah.
So in that sense, would you not agree that this is somewhat a zero-sum market-led game?
You see, I mean, higher education, I think the more competition you have, the better it's going to be in terms of both the students and also for the faculties involved. One has to be a bit careful when you look at the primary and secondary sector of education. We talk about the Punjab Education Foundation, which is essentially a public-private partnership. The reason why private partnerships are forwarded as solutions is because in a developing country, you have financial constraints. So the government sometimes does not have the resources. So it's a nice way of leveraging finance, having public-private partnerships. But having said that, in primary education or secondary education, government cannot withdraw from its obligation of providing free and good quality basic education to the people. It's enshrined in the constitution of the country. So PPP initiatives, where you galvanize the private sector, where you have things like voucher schemes or empanelment of private schools under regulatory environment, that helps leveraging resources and helps the public sector in meeting this huge demand coming out there. It doesn't absolve the government from providing free and good quality education. And if you look at the case of Pakistan, I mean, we in terms of our educational budget are one of the lowest in the region, and one of the lowest also in other compared to other developing countries, sub-Saharan Africa. We just give 2% to the education sector, which is much lower. So it needs to be increased to at least 4%. So PPP initiatives are important, but as I said, it's not a complete substitute for government provision of in a sector where there are huge market failures and equity issues.
Okay. Ms. Wazirli and Javaid Saab, I'd like both of you to just address this particular scene with special regard to higher education. Both of you are, you know, leading institutions. So just that, and then of course you can continue what you were just going to say.
I think that we've talked about what makes for a successful organization, and many people are fairly familiar with the key components. But I think the central question really that is to be asked in Pakistan is that out of 178 universities, for example, why is it that there are two really at the top? And certainly I think you can add Aghan University. And I would say that Foreman Christian College is demonstrating a lot of remarkable qualities of a successful organization, and so is Habib, although it's very new. So maybe a handful of universities. So the question is, what's going to happen with 171 other institutions?
Right.
Why is it that the public sector doesn't reform? Because I think that the characteristics of outstanding and effective and efficient organizations and legitimate and resilient organizations, it's wonderful that it has been presented in this manner, very readable and very easy to comprehend. But most people who look at institutions pretty much know what are the key characteristics. So the question is, how is Pakistan going to transition into effective, large-scale public sector organizations? I'm talking about the university sector right now, the tertiary sector. And it's equally applicable, I think, to the other sectors. And that question still remains formidable and is unanswered. Why is Karachi University not an effective university?
Even though it used to be.
Institution? Yeah. And similarly others. Is it over-regulation? Is it the fact that there's a charter dictated by the Higher Education Commission, and therefore they have no freedom to be to determine some of their own pathways? There are many other issues, of course, that can be identified, that public sector is not really accountable. I mean, you can have 30,000 students in a university, most of them don't pay enough fee really to even meet 20% of the budget of the university, but they will continue and professors will either come in and teach or not teach, and the university will still be there. So I think the question for Pakistan is, if there are efficient, effective organizations, not just these few and several others in the private sector, why is it that these transformative elements of institutional development are not being adopted when we talk about reform, whether it's reform in the education sector, in the health sector, in the corporate sector, or any of the autonomous organizations also of government? And I think this is the stickler, because we are very rigidified into public sector organizations. So lessons like this, and wonderful candles in the dark, and there will be several other candles in the dark as well, how do you move forward? You know, how does this prescription apply? And why is it not being taken, as a central to the measures for reform?
Yeah, to put in the same poetic sense, how do you light one candle from the other lit candle? Javaid Saab, something from your side before we open up for Q&A.
Yeah, I think many candles have not survived the storm. But your question was on higher education,
yes,
and
course.
What Madam said. You know, I tend to sort of simplify this. I wonder sometimes, we blame regulatory bodies like the HEC, like the government. But is the fault really there, or is it somewhere else? Is the fault in human capacity, in our skill sets, in our abilities to comprehend? Maybe I'm oversimplifying it. Maybe I'm thinking like a child when I say, what is the value chain of higher education? It's the students who come into higher education, and then the value chain of the institution from where they are coming in. But let's just look at the higher education. They get admitted. There are three primary functions that any higher education institution has to perform. That is excellent teaching, or rather learning of the students, research that is relevant to industry and that is linked to the curriculum and not anything else. And finally, the outreach community activities. I think it's a very simple value chain. If this value chain is put into place, if the curriculum modules are put into place, the best practices in the world as they apply in this part of the world, research that is linked to these modules and which is then relevant to our industry and our users and outreach activities. I don't think the regulatory bodies are stopping us from doing that. I'm not quite sure what is it that is preventing us from putting this value chain in place. Is it that I'm off the track completely, or is it something else?
Right. This is such a broad topic, and I'm afraid an hour is very short, but I will allow the audience to share our thoughts. There's a question there in the gentleman. Can please somebody pass him a mic? I request you, sir, to please introduce yourself and a short question.
Okay, my name is Dr. Mohammed Wasi Barclay. I just wanted to, you mentioned about 1122 and it's being very effective. And yesterday, Ms. Sharmeen Chenoy also endorsed this by saying that in a rural Punjab, such quick action was taken to save the life of a girl of Karokari. So I just want to know, how does what was the motivating factor that in the rural Punjab, 1122 was so effective and it is working so well? She said the system is working very well.
Okay, so a very short answer, and it's connected to what I said earlier, that if you actually go to the constituencies, if you look at district-wise Punjab, you'll see that on top of a politician's list of what services they would like is 1122. Primarily because it established a reputation when it started off in Lahore of very good service delivery. But then there's other issue which is connected to that. I mean, they provide you first aid help, but you go to an RHC or you go to a hospital which is nearby. So the bottleneck comes at the final provision of healthcare. If that is not there, so there's going to be an issue. Okay, so it is providing very good service, but then the health final healthcare providers, that's where the issue is.
Right.
Arizman, I think it's a very important book. I only hope it gets international visibility. But I think what characterizes many of the organizations seems to be trust. Yeah. And I don't know whether in your analysis you were able to look more specifically at the dynamics of what drives trust within those organizations. And if we build on from trust, it's reputation. There's been a lot of work now being done in the area of reputation risk. And there are many examples of organizations that have been managed well, but then reputation risk is not even looked at and they implode. So that is around governance. Did you look at those kinds of things as well? And areas like resilience, there's also been international work being done on that. That is also very important. So the other thing is around technology. There are global trends out there in terms of technology, in terms of regulatory developments that might impact developments in Pakistan. To what extent did you look at those things, really external factors that may well impact the organization's futures?
Let me just pick up a couple of points. First of all, on the question of trust, I think you're absolutely right. It's critical. And institutions where the leadership and the team of the leaders is trusted, clearly they do well, whether it's Wazir Income Support Program or IBA. The funding for IBA, for example, for infrastructure, in my opinion, would not have happened if the people who were donating the money did not trust Dr. Ishrat Hussain. So trust is extremely important in that sense. On technology, I think a good example is NADRA, where they have really used technology very efficiently. And it's become a standard bearer, not just in this country, but it has major international projects where it is competing with IBM and others very effectively. So,
there's a question over here. But ma'am, can I request you to please come forward? We can't really...
Okay. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Kehkisha Awan. My question to the panel is around the performance management systems within organizations. Are we equipped to bring in the transformation which is required at this point? And why I'm raising this is because my own perception is that we are still using management systems which were very pertinent to the manufacturing era. And though we have entered all over the world, globally, we now function in a knowledge management era. On top of that, we have more than 4 to 5 generations today working in one organization. So managing people is more complex than it used to be. We did touch upon transformational leadership, and the question that brought to my mind was whether our higher educational institutes are equipped or are equipping the leaders to deal with management in today's era. Thank you.
Yes, certainly I think one needs to adopt modernized management techniques. There's a lot written on management, so I won't take too long to respond to you. Clearly the answer is yes, but I think part of the answer is also the context within which the institution finds itself. And there are certain management arrangements, there are some principles of management, but there are certain management arrangements which are related to scale, for example. Scale, scope, what is the mission, and so forth. Yes, of course, one needs very carefully to look at how an institution is administered. To me, the motorway police, for example, is really a remarkable initiative of government, and it has survived for so many years, and it's upheld high standards. So in this whole sea of generally what people say a very inefficient policing system, you have the motorway police. They're as good as any police anywhere in the world. And they, for those who have driven back and forth on the motorways, know that once you're facing a motorway policeman, you've got to abide by the traffic rules. There's no getting away from it. But you go down here to any intersection and you can just cross a red light and nothing will happen. So I think a lot depends upon the context within which certain institutions have been developed and the protection that they have been given, the incentives, the protection, the outcome, accountability measures, and reward for good performance. And all of these are related to management.
With regards to motorway police, there's actually an interesting statistic about the number of tickets they've given to VIPs. So that's, yes. I think that's...
No, I think in motorway police, it's actually really a change of culture.
Gee.
That you have a group of officers who are extremely courteous. Even when they catch you, they're very nice to you. But they will make sure, as Shahnaz mentioned, they will make sure that the law is upheld.
Gee.
My name is Ishan. Why the organizations for the profits are kept out of the perspective of this book?
Could you repeat that?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
Organizations for the profit organizations are kept out of the perspective of this book.
Well, I think the reason for that is that work on organizations in the private sector that are for profit basis have a huge literature, and the issues are very apparent. They have a bottom line which has to be met, and so in this case we were not really looking at private except for private for non-profit. So that's the reason. There's a lot of literature already that exists worldwide on it.
The gentleman in the glasses, straight, yes. It's on. I think it's on. Ji.
That only institutes like LUMS and IBA, they produce good students and good managers. Whereas if you look at the history, the top managers mostly, they are from a very humble background. I can give you example of Dr. Abdul Qadir Khan. He did his FSC from DJ College, I believe, and then engineering from NED University. Dr. Salam, and list can go on and on. So why this perception has been created that only good students can be produced from these high-end universities?
I don't think that's the perception, actually. Individuals can excel no matter what background they come from. I don't think that's the equation that is being made here, that if you're a very effective organization, you're the only one producing good students. But you know, there are many, many others. The Lahore University of Engineering and Technology is outstanding. Mm-hmm. So is the Faisalabad University of Agriculture. And there are many universities that have centers of excellence with them. So I think that's another thing that we need to look at. Despite a dysfunctional university, you can have an outstanding center of excellence.
Would the authors like to respond? Or can we just say it's not an exhaustive list?
I think that's
the response.
Yeah.
Okay. Turab?
I think it's not a question of why. I mean, it actually makes a case of why not improve the public sector in higher education.
No, as we mentioned, the list is really by the very fact that we can't cover all the successful ones. Right.
Because sure. Because they mentioned the book in the second edition, I'm sure they're going to cover 20th institutions. So we can do
you
that.
No, we have to. We can't have a universal coverage. It has to be a sample drawn from some universe.
Second edition. There's a question all the way at the back. The lady in the glasses.
Yes.
Not all the way back, but the middle. Yes.
Yes.
Can you please get up, ma'am? Not you, but the one behind you.
Okay.
Can you please give it to her because she was in line? Can you please give it to her?
I was in line as well. Okay.
We'll take your next one.
Thank you. I just have a very, I suppose, a simple question, is that we talked a lot about leadership and leadership-driven successful organizations, and of course how that translates into sustainability in the next sort of phase of the life cycle of the organization. We talked also about how it's important to codify certain, you know, value systems and processes and systems to ensure that this sustainability is there. But then we also talk about how important it is in terms of having the right leadership and the vision. My question is, where do you make that leap of faith from leadership into institutionalization and creating new leadership for the sustainability of the organization? Thank you.
Sayyid Yavar Ali is just about to leave, but he could well answer that question as well in the private sector. I think it's a process. Perhaps other panel members want to respond. There's a timeline and there's a process, and it will happen if the visionary leader has put in place the right arrangements.
Exactly.
I think it's, how do you define visionary leadership? The way we define visionary leadership is an understanding of the importance of building an institution. So I think that's the critical thing which you're talking about. So if they realize that processes, procedure, rules, codification is important, so legacy issues. So these are things which actually define what you're calling visionary leadership. That making an institution should be part and parcel of that.
If I can make a question now.
Please.
My name is Majubeen Rizvi. With reference to public-private partnership, I just wanted to know if the public-private partnership has been examined in the province of Sindh, because I work in an organization which works with as public-private partnership, empowering school operators across Sindh for underprivileged students. There's a high level of ad hocism in that sector. I just wanted to know, I mean, has that been examined in this book, in your studies? Because, I mean, how to check ad hocism at large?
Okay.
I mean, you make implementation partners, they're partners, but the job is still undefined. I mean, there's a lot of gray areas. How do you check that?
I think to answer the first part of your question, we haven't looked at Sindh. So there's an education foundation in Sindh. We haven't looked at it. Perhaps we will in the future. With regard to public-private partnership under PEF, its objectives and programs are very well defined, and that's one of the reasons why you check ad hocism. There are essentially three programs they run, and the systems are very clear-cut. You know, you have the voucher scheme, you have the foundation-assisted school, and then you have this other program by which you allow the private sector to adopt government schools. And there are monitoring mechanisms which actually prevent such ad hocism to take place, and the procedures, as I said, are fairly well defined in that. We haven't looked at Sindh, no.
This is the last question. There's a gentleman
My name is Ali Jafar Zaidi, and my company is partner to the SAP Global in SAP Education Learning Hub. Parvez Sahib, I really appreciate your saying that the education value chain is really is the answer of the time. We should work very seriously on education value chain. If we don't identify the value chain of education, we are nowhere. Our industry and education are there running like a railway line. They do not meet anywhere. We have to integrate. We have to integrate industry with education. Industry has to give demands to the education industry what they need and what they do not need. That is the thing. These people sitting on the helm of the affairs of the universities, they do not know anything, I'm telling you. So they are not abreast with the current technology. When I visit the universities, I tell them, they are taken aback. I have categorized the vice chancellors of the university in three categories. The 18th century vice chancellors, the 19th century vice chancellors, and the 21st century vice chancellors. The 18th century vice chancellors, they do not understand what I am talking. Really, I am telling you. This is the pathetic thing. And they are all nominated.
Please get to the question. Do you have a question, sir?
Yes, I have a question. That why the panel is discussing only two or three universities. There is a university in Lahari. There is a university in Lahari.
I'm afraid we have already covered that question.
Yes.
But thank you for your comments.
Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. We've covered that question. Thank you so much for all your time. I would like to thank the distinguished panel, our co-authors, who may be affected by another public institution which is going through some time, so they may be here on Monday also. But thank you for your time, ladies and gentlemen. We'll closing this session. Thank you so much.